Okay, for the next couple of weeks, we're going to be talking about sedimentation and diffusion. We're going to basically cover chapter 5, I think it's 0.1 to 5.3, and the new edition of Van Hold. But we're also going to refer to some of the material from an old edition. I've posted those chapters as well. It's chapter 4 and 5. They were separately on diffusion and sedimentation years ago. 1971, if I read the... Yeah, 1971. I think that's the original version of Ken's book. So the traditional way of doing this, and by traditional, of course, I mean in older textbooks, back when we had older technology, involves a lot of graphical analysis of the data. And so I'm going to present all of this the way I learned it in the 70s and the way I have presented it for many decades. But the goal at the end is to introduce you to what the modern version of all of this is. What has changed is primarily that in the 70s, we used to literally shoot pictures on film. We used to have glass plates that were sort of 5 frames long that had emulsion on them, and we would shoot 5 pictures, and then we would develop that picture and use those data to analyze the experiment. And I'll describe that again later when we get to it. At some point in the 70s, my lab started going to film. So we would cut a piece of film that fit into a holder that was the size of this piece of glass, and it would fit into a holder in a way that I could snap pictures, and then I would have to develop that film in exactly the same way. And we literally would turn the lights off in the room and develop the film and then look at the pictures. And then at some point also in the 70s, my group, at the University of Connecticut, went to diode arrays. So these are basically cameras that accepted light and gave you an image of what it was seeing. The original array was actually a one-dimensional array, and so it got very simple data across the cell. Eventually, we went to a rectangular array. And those images were hooked up to a small computer. You can't imagine what our computers looked like in those days. They were much bigger than what we have now and had absolutely no memory in them. They were very limited in what they could do. And then it wasn't until the early 90s that new technology came out from Beckman, the company that has made the centrifuge for some 70 years, that interfaced directly into a computer and wrote data out onto a file. And so once that happened in the early 90s, the late 80s, the early 90s, the whole field changed, because suddenly now we had as much data as we were willing to collect in a format that allowed us to do certain kinds of computation. And so it was after that the field dramatically changed, and how we analyze data today is completely different than what we used to do. And so I'll expose you to that at the end of next week and probably the third week. That said, I still like to present this stuff in the way that I'm presenting it to you, so you have some sort of foundation into what these principles are and where they come from. And so you're going to see a lot of things that are, one might say, obsolete, or they're certainly in new formats these days. I think it really helps to sort of understand what the principles are. So I'll have a number of things to say about all of this. The main thing is to understand that we're measuring diffusion and sedimentation. So we're measuring a diffusion constant and we're measuring a sedimentation coefficient. And what do we learn by measuring those numbers? And then when we look at those numbers as a function of concentration, what do we potentially learn about the molecules and the systems that we're working on? So this chapter begins with these four concepts. And so appreciate that this chapter in the new book was a merging of diffusion, sedimentation, and electrophoresis. And so suddenly this summary reflects three topics, not a single topic. Okay. And so statement number one, is it a simple polypeptide or an aggregate of several chains? Okay. And so that first concept is basically asking, is it a monomer or is it a polymer? Okay. I say down below the term aggregate often means irreversible, aggregated protein. If we want something to be reversible, if we want something to have a concentration-dependent equilibrium constant, then we generally think in terms of polymers or oligomers or some kind of a complex. Okay, and then as soon as you do that, the question that arises is, okay, what's the size of the polymer? Is it a dimer? Is it a trimer? Is it a tetramer? Is it a mixture of all the above, et cetera? Okay, so what's the assembly model? Point number two is about homogeneity. Is there one chain or are there several kinds of chains? And then what are their approximate molecular weights? We really mean exact molecular weights, but within experimental error. So is it a monomer that makes a dimer? Is it two monomers that make a heterodimer? Is it an alpha beta like hemoglobin? Is it two chains that make a tetramer, et cetera? Okay, so those are the kinds of questions that we're thinking about. When we present this stuff to you, again, remember my point that everything in textbooks comes from a paper. All of this information about proteins, their oligomer sizes and their kinetic mechanisms of action and how they're regulated, et cetera, all came from experiments like the experiments that I've been describing here. And so at some point, somebody had to measure the fact that something is a dimer or a tetramer made up of multiple kinds of chains. The third point really has to do with shape. Okay, it's a monomer, but is it a sphere? Is it a rod? Okay, it's a polymer, but again, is it sort of globular in shape? Hemoglobin is essentially globular in shape. It's not perfectly a sphere, but it's not extended. Many proteins and their assemblages are fibrous or extended. And so that changes its solution properties. It changes potentially its its function and its interactions with other molecules. And then the fourth point here is making a reference primarily to the electrophoresis section, which we've already covered. Okay, and so this is really asking questions about its amino acid composition and what its mobility is in a, some kind of a gel. Okay, and it could be referring to native gels, so things like Ferguson analysis, or it could be referring to denaturing gels. And so does it run to the anode or the cathode? And what do you learn about its size and ionic character? Okay, and so that's sort of an overview of what they're trying to cover. So we're gonna have to get you guys even more out of the way here. Okay. So there's a sort of a digression at the beginning of this chapter and in most presentations of this, because up until this point, we were spending a lot of time talking about thermodynamics, talking about reversible equilibria. So talking about what equilibria means, talking about state functions and thermodynamic functions. And as soon as you start talking about diffusion and sedimentation and electrophoresis, you're setting up experiments that are not at equilibrium. You're setting up conditions where you have sharp gradients or you have sharp boundaries and you have resolution of material into different regions, different boundaries, different bands. And so it causes us to introduce a concept called flow. And that means that there's a migration of material, usually down some kind of a gradient, usually in response to some kind of a force. Okay. I just moved my microphone so that it was in front of my mouth, if my voice suddenly got a little clearer. So the introduction here, and there's only going to be a small section where this sort of comes up, but the introduction usually talks about this as non-equilibrium or non-equilibrium thermodynamics or irreversible thermodynamics, because it'll be under conditions where we're not actually at equilibrium, and yet we're still sort of using the concept of chemical potential and concepts that we've already sort of discussed and have been involved in our presentation. So this picture represents one-dimensional flow, diffusion. And the question that's being asked here down below is how much material is moving across this boundary, which is so many centimeters squared in area. And so we define the flow. Usually we use the term J or J sub I for the ith component. The flow of a particular substance is the net number of moles or grams that crosses the surface 1 square centimeter per unit time. So it's grams per centimeter squared per second. Okay, so how much flow is there across this boundary? And so we're going to want to think about this in those terms when we get down to writing down equations. Okay. This is stolen from one of the other chapters. There's a different version of this that I'll show in a little while from this chapter in the modern Van Hold or the more recent Van Hold, which is still pretty old. It's the response of a solution to a force, and it begins to migrate. And so the x-axis is time after the force is applied. The force could be electrophoretic charge, electric field. It could be a rotating field in a centrifuge. It could be some kind of a gradient in a diffusion apparatus, okay? And we're going to look at the rate at which a particle moves. So we'll call it the velocity. And the point that's being made is that when a particle moves due to some force, there's a counterforce. And this is what happens in these Xeroxes of grayed out material. But the counterforce is arrows moving in the opposite direction. You notice that you can see these opposite resistance forces trace out the shape of the molecule. So the shape of the molecule will be a factor in this. The resistance force will depend upon the velocity multiplied times a frictional coefficient. Okay, so there'll be a driving force and then there'll be a resistance force. And it's written up above that the velocity is the force divided by the resistance or the frictional coefficient. But if you rearrange this, it's the velocity times F is going to be equal to the force. But what ends up happening is that you reach a steady state here, a steady state where the particle is moving at some constant velocity, okay, depending on what the force is. And so that constant velocity is reflected in the fact that the resistance and the force have to sum up to some kind of a zero value, right? And the sign here, don't worry about that. It has something to do with describing the nature of the force. And we'll do that more correctly when we derive some things down below. Okay. And so there's going to be a resistance. But the resistance is going to give us information about the frictional coefficient. It's going to give us information about the size and the frictional coefficient, because the frictional coefficient will depend upon the size. Now, an older book shows this transport process in sort of general terms. And it treats each of these in a similar sort of way. So if you have electrical conduction, then you have some kind of an electrostatic potential, and then you have a flow of electrons, okay? And so once particles start moving, there's this uniform electrostatic potential. And so you will have a flow that reflects the potential and some kind of a connector term. And we'll talk about what these connector terms are. Okay, so mathematically, this is usually described as minus the gradient of the potential. As it shows up as a derivative, a partial derivative with respect to position. So X here is a position. Okay, heat conduction falls into the same class of transport processes. There's a temperature gradient. So that's where the potential comes from. There's a flow of heat. And the state of equilibrium is usually a uniform temperature. Diffusion, we've actually talked about some of this already in osmotic pressure, where we talk about a chemical potential difference. It's a flow of molecules to establish a constant chemical potential across a membrane, across some kind of a barrier. And then the goal is a uniform chemical potential. And osmotic pressure, we also had to introduce a pressure difference to maintain a chemical potential difference, okay? But nonetheless, it was a chemical potential difference, a gradient in concentration that gave us the driving force for the diffusion across the membrane. Sedimentation ends up being what we call a total potential because there's a chemical potential, there's a concentration difference that is generated by sedimentation. So there's a flow of molecules, but they're responding to some kind of a centrifugal potential energy. And so when we talk about equilibrium for sedimentation, it will be a uniform total potential where there'll be a concentration gradient that offsets the potential gradient set up by the centrifuge force, okay? And so these are the general ideas. And so the general equation, a flow in terms of a connector in some kind of a derivative, is true for all of these. And this is the general form of the equation that we can use for all kinds of non-equilibrium or irreversible thermodynamic processes. Now, this is taken out of one of the sections just to show you what that connector ends up being. It uses something like Ohm's law as a generalized form. And we're talking about this conductivity term, this L term, okay? And so it's giving you some kind of a rule that basically says the further is the system from equilibrium, the bigger the gradient, okay? The faster it moves towards equilibrium. So the establishment of a gradient is what introduces the force, and it's the force that therefore then determines the velocity. Okay, so the velocity will depend upon the force, which depends upon the gradient. Okay, and so they're sort of walking you through some kind of a derivation here of where the velocity comes from, where the force comes from. This is from the previous slide, basically. And the fact that the velocity depends on the force with some kind of a connector, the velocity times the concentration gives you the total flow, or how much material is being transported, how much material is moving at what rate, and that's the total flow that you get out of the system. Okay, and then the frictional coefficient, which ends up being related to this connector term, this L term, is the term that we're really looking for, because that's the frictional coefficient that we'll be able to interpret in terms of molecular parameters of the molecules that we're studying. Okay, so pictorially, this chapter and the older chapters use a simple diagram like this. If you have a starting condition where there's a sharp boundary and you have some molecule below the boundary and none of them above the boundary, this is a gradient, and the gradient will establish some kind of diffusional flow from bottom to top, okay? And so sometime later, the particles will penetrate and begin to establish a uniform concentration, and then at some infinite time, sometime later, there will be a uniform concentration of whatever the maximum is, whatever the macromolecule is. All right. And so notice that it's trying to describe this in terms of flow parameters and thinking about it in terms of flow, but it's also thinking about this in terms of free energy and entropy, okay? And so the driving force tells you something about the free energy differences, okay? When you get to equilibrium, we're talking about a minimum in free energy. But when you get to equilibrium, we're also talking about a maximum entropy, meaning a maximum distribution of particles. So here there's a separation or a gradient in particles, and that's a minimum entropy. When you get to randomness of all of the particles, that's when you have the maximum entropy. And so this is all still relatable to concepts in thermodynamics. Now, I'm going to do this in a couple of different ways and in a couple of different steps. This version of chapter 5 of diffusion sort of jumps right in. It doesn't derive this stuff, and I'll redo this in a few slides. Okay, but the idea is that in this situation in figure 5.2, there's a concentration gradient, and the concentration gradient causes a flow. So this is the force, and this is a response to the force. The connector in this case is the diffusion coefficient. Okay, how many molecules are going to move? It starts out with a one-dimensional diffusion problem, and it simply writes this down as though it's an analogy to what I had up above in terms of generalized equations. A flow is equal to some kind of a connector times a gradient. So there's a concentration gradient. The connector in this case is D, the diffusion coefficient. And we can use this relationship, which is also known as Fick's first law, to measure a diffusion coefficient. And as the gradient disappears, the flow stops, and we get this uniform distribution of molecules, okay? And so that's what this is introducing, all right? And so they then introduce this in a slightly different way. They show you imagine flow coming into or out of a sphere, into or out of a cell, into or out of any kind of imagined biological problem that is in principle solvable mathematically. But for our purposes, we'll simply ask a simple question of a flow across two boundaries, which means a flow through some kind of space. And the question will be how much material in and how much material out. So initially it was just a single boundary, but now we actually want to think about this in terms of the total volume and how much material is going into that volume and how much material is coming out of that volume, okay? And we can think of this in terms of diffusion or sedimentation or electrophoresis, all right? So now we put it into a mathematical concept. Imagine a flow through this box. It's flowing through this surface. So it's so much material is crossing this surface per unit time, okay? So the total change in concentration, which is represented here as delta W, which I think they define as weight. So the change in the amount of mass is the flow at surface X times the area times the unit time, okay? And so that's how much is flowing into the box. And then the change in mass in the box is dictated by how much flows out of the box. And so it's the flow at X plus delta X. This is now a definition of a box. We will vary eventually the size of the box in terms of calculus, times the area. In this case, it's a cube, so the area is the same. It need not be the same, times the time. And so this will be a description mathematically of the amount of material that's flowing into and flowing out of some kind of a volume, all right? So if you then rearrange the equation and you take A delta X, it's in both terms to the left, then this becomes a change in concentration. How much mass per unit volume, because it's area times the distance of X, so that defines a volume. This ends up being centimeters cubed, for example. So that's a change in concentration, right? And then what you have is the flow terms, X minus X plus delta X times delta time. And if you divide that by the delta X as well, okay, this ends up being the flow per unit time, the flow across a particular distance. Okay, so what have we derived here? We're going to take now the time to the left, and we're going to have the time divided by the concentration. So this ends up being what is called the change in concentration per unit time in this volume element is equal to the flow divided by the change in position, okay? And so we're expressing this in the change in concentration per unit time is equal to a flow per unit position. This is all done in simple sort of deltas to reflect a cube, but what we want to do is drive these limits to infinitesimally small limits. So I said this would become calculus. So the change in concentration per unit time at small units of time is equal to the flow.
Delta Cray.
Yeah.
I thought it delta C over delta T equal delta J negative delta J, because I thought delta X on the numerator is cancel the delta X in the
They don't cancel because these are two different positions.
Oh, I see.
It's the amount of flow that's occurring reflects the change in concentration, but we are separating this into a time coordinate and a position coordinate.
Okay, got you.
So initially things often are uniform or they often have a gradient, and we want to know how much of a change in concentration there is per unit time at every position in the cell. And so then we have to know what the flow is per unit position. To take a derivative of this and drive it to small t and small r, these become partial derivatives. So by writing this as a partial derivative, what you're really doing is you're saying, what's the change in concentration per unit time at a constant r, and that's reflected as the flow per unit position at constant t. Okay, so the partial derivative reflects to the fact that we're going to be looking at every position for a change in time, and at every the concentration change over time at a given position, and the flow at a given position per unit time. Okay, and so we want these to be relatable to one another. This is generally known as the continuity equation. And so what we need here is an explicit definition of flow. And if we can put in an equation for flow, then we can write this down in a much more explicit way. Okay, and so the flow equation is Fick's first law. And so if we plug Fick's first law into here, okay, which was the minus d dc dx, then this becomes a second law from Fick, the change in concentration with time. Notice the negative signs cancel, is the diffusion coefficient times a second derivative in concentration with x. All right, and so this allows us to solve for different kinds of arrangements, different shapes, boxes and spheres and irregular structures, all of which is in principle relatable to a diffusion coefficient. Now, you need more complex math to solve these other problems is what it's implying, but in most of our arrangements, we're going to be using simple one, two-dimensional flow to make everything sort of solvable. So at this point in most introductions to diffusion, they imagine simple scenarios. And the simple scenario that they imagine is a slight slab, is the term that they use, of material of thickness delta, centered at x equals zero. And then the question is, how does it diffuse as a function of time? All right. And so we can depict this as a one-dimensional height box, or we can depict this as a slab in three dimensions. The upper panel is sort of solving for the total concentration distribution per unit time. And the bottom panel is showing you the motion of the particles. So the particles on average are simply moving randomly in the slab. But since the concentration is higher in the box, on average, they move out of the box more than they move into the box. And so they begin to spread or diffuse with some diffusion coefficient. And so without going through all the details of this, the solution to this problem is the solution to this differential equation. And given some initial values of conditions, this is the solution to the problem. What's the concentration as a function of x and t? It's the initial concentration times the slab thickness. So that tells you the total amount of material. It's divided by some term that involves the square root of d and t times an exponential expression, which expresses the fact that the material is going to move both left and right with a coefficient e to the minus x squared. That's the position, and it's squared, so it applies to left and right, divided by 4dt. So the diffusion coefficient becomes the central determinant of what's happening here. The delta and the C naught are simply initial conditions. What's the concentration? What's the slab thickness? How you make this is a different question. You generally don't do experiments exactly this way. Although when we run a gel and we put a small bit of material in a well at the top of the gel, this is essentially what we're doing. And then it electrophoreses in one dimension. It only goes to the right or to the left. And so that becomes an initial condition for simulating, for example, or analyzing sedimentation of material. Okay, and so that's sort of a general way of thinking about what we're doing. Generally, the field often wants to know something about the average change in position. So it expresses this in terms of derivatives averaged over concentrations across all positions. This uses something called definite integrals. I'll show you this later. I won't stop now to show you this. There are books that you may or may not know about of integrals of different kinds of derivatives. And they're simply tables that people use to look up what is the derivative of x squared e to the minus x squared with or without constants. And then what is the derivative, or what is the integral of e to the minus x squared with or without some kind of constant? Okay. And so there are published values that you can then plug in here to solve this. But the issue here is that the average change in position of the boundary is a reflection of the diffusion coefficient. So again, another way of getting at diffusion coefficients. Now, experimentally, starting in the 40s, I think it was in the 40s, people would set up these sharp boundaries. That this should remind you of the U-shaped electrophoresis apparatus. There was a sharp boundary established with high concentration or an initial concentration. And then at some time it started to diffuse. And over time, the shape of the boundary gave you information about the change in concentration with time at each position. So again, you can think of this as being potentially the continuity equation, where the concentration is varying with time at each position. And so the flow at each position gave you the change in concentration per unit time. I'm basically restating the continuity equation. And the solution to this particular problem involves some kind of an initial term, which reflects how this material will eventually spread, and then some exponential term, which sort of looks like the solutions up above. Notice now it's only going in one direction here, although their spreading is occurring in both directions. Okay, so it's going from zero to x, but then it's reflected into both sides of the axis about x equals zero. Okay, now I'm going to come back to some of this in a little bit. Because we're going to derive something similar to this for our other situations. So what this is really doing is it's giving you an introduction to flow of material in response to a concentration gradient. Okay, the connector is a diffusion coefficient. All right. So that's what we get. We get a diffusion coefficient out of this. So what? what do we do with the diffusion coefficient? All right. So you do or don't know that many, many years ago, Einstein's is around 1905. Einstein came up with this simple equation for a diffusion coefficient. He was basically thinking about Brownian motion. And he came up with this expression that D is equal to KT, Boltzmann's constant times absolute temperature divided by a frictional coefficient, okay? K, I think you know, times N is R, the gas constant. And so if you multiply and divide by Avogadro's number, this is the form of the equation you get, okay? So a diffusion coefficient can be expressed in this way. And what you get out of diffusion coefficient is a frictional coefficient. So you can interpret these data if you know something about frictional coefficients. Now, sometime in that same period of time, Stokes determined the frictional coefficient for a sphere. And he knows this, or he solved this as 6 pi eta, which is the viscosity, times A, which is the radius of the sphere. So this equation below is substituting an equation for the frictional coefficient. And so this equation is generally known as the Stokes-Einstein equation, because it uses Stokes' equation for frictional coefficient of a sphere and Einstein's equation for diffusion coefficient. So if you measure D and your particle is a sphere, you can measure the radius of the particle. You got to know the viscosity. Everything else in here is a constant. 6 pi Avogadro's number, gas constant times temperature. So again, you get diffusion coefficients, which gets you frictional coefficients, which gets you radius of a sphere, if it is a sphere. So we're now turning a diffusion coefficient into information about a molecule. Now, we're interested mostly in macromolecules, but that's what this is allowing you to do. It was recognized a long time ago that particles are not generally, or macromolecules are not generally spheres. And certainly prior to modern molecular biology, where we could take crystal structures and look at the actual shapes of things, people spent a lot of time thinking about the frictional coefficient of shapes, okay? And the three traditional shapes that people studied are long rods, prolates, and oblates, okay? So a prolate is essentially a football, and an oblate is essentially a frisbee or a disc, and then a rod is what it is, a rod, okay? Long rod. And you can imagine macromolecules having sort of flattened structures or sort of elliptical, football-like shapes or rod-like structures. And you can imagine not just macromolecules, but assemblies of macromolecules having these dimensions. All right. Now, the P here is a term. Here it's called alpha over beta. It's often called A over B, where alpha is what's called the semi-major axis, half length for a rod, and B is the minor axis, the radius of a rod. And you can imagine a similar sort of thing for a football and an oblate. What's the dimensions? Let me write it down here, if I can get over to that space. If you actually had something that looked sort of like a football, what's this dimension and what's that dimension? And what's the half dimension, okay? And then for a disc, if you had a disc where that's supposed to be a disc, not a football, it would have a width of a disc, and then it would also have a radius. And frisbees, of course, are usually spheres. And so on its side, you could imagine a thickness and a width across the disc, okay? And so those would be the P terms. So these are other kinds of equations for frictional coefficients that were derived in the 30s, basically, by a guy by the name of Perrin, P-E-R-R-I-N. That is usually in all of these tables, actually, depending upon where it's presented. So the traditional way of doing this stuff is to thinking naively about a diffusion coefficient giving you a frictional coefficient of a sphere or a frictional coefficient of an equivalent sphere, okay? Imagine the volume of the particle turned into a sphere. Whatever that volume is, if it's a sphere, what would be its frictional coefficient? And so that's what this parameter over here usually represents. It's often represented as RE. The quantity is the radius of a sphere equal in volume to the ellipsoid or rod. Okay, so that's what the F naught is. If this were a sphere, let's turn this entire volume into a sphere. It would have this radius. That would have a frictional coefficient of F naught. It's not a sphere, so how much bigger is it, F over F naught, than a sphere? Okay, so if a sphere had 6 pi eta radius of a sphere, what is this F value relative to that equivalent value? Okay, that's basically what this is asking. All right, and so we often express stuff as a ratio of F over F naught to get a sense of how much bigger the frictional coefficient is going to be relative to the sphere. There's nothing more compact than a sphere. All right, and so this is a plot of those data. Notice now the axis suddenly these must be from different chapters. So now the radius is not alpha over beta, it's A over B. And so imagine this axial ratio, and they're showing us what the F over F naught is for both this oblate or prolate structures, okay? And so imagine these very dramatically different axial ratios. So these are really irregular shapes that we're imagining here. How does the frictional coefficient change depending upon these shapes? And it's showing you the initial part of the curve as an insert down here. So these are maybe more realistic axial ratios for the macromolecules that we often think about, and how the prolate and oblate more or less look the same up until about 5% variation. Okay. And so this is showing what the deviation is going to be. Now, the value here is extrapolated to one. So it's basically saying that for a sphere, an axial ratio of one, okay, this ratio will give you a value of one. All right. And so that's basically thinking about this as a geometry problem or a trigonometry problem where you're comparing unusual shapes to spheres and you vary the axial ratio to collapse it to what would look like a sphere. So in the limit, it will look like a sphere. Okay. Now, we're going to slightly change directions here, and I'm going to derive this again one more time because I want to be able to talk about this in a lot more detail. And so in chapter 4 from the earlier version, the flow equation was written down in terms of a change in the chemical potential. So now the change in the chemical potential, before I simply said a change in concentration, but in this earlier version, it actually used the proper term, which is the chemical potential, and the gradient now is the driving force for the flow. And then it expands this derivative so that it's d mu dc dc dx, okay? And so this is a little calculus trick where you can expand this out in terms of terms. At constant temperature and pressure, remember in some of our earlier stuff, pressure was a variable. So we had to take into account the pressure. Okay, but if we're assuming constant temperature and constant pressure, then the change in the chemical potential per unit X can be expanded in terms of d mu dc dc dx. And notice all of these are partial derivatives. So we're assuming something is being held constant while we're doing this, okay? So now what we're going to do is we're going to take this derivative and we're going to actually differentiate the term in terms of a definition of what concentration is. And you will remember in some of our previous derivations that we could write chemical potentials down in terms of concentration. And so I don't have it written down here in the, I thought I had it written down here. I'm going to write it down here. Out here. That the chemical potential can be written down as a constant chemical potential, a standard state chemical potential, plus RT ln concentration times an activity coefficient. So we derived this early on out of one of the earlier chapters in Van Hold, and this is what we use to talk about various parameters. Now, if you then take the derivative with respect to C of this term, you will end up with an expression that looks like this, okay? You'll end up with two terms here, the natural logarithm of C, plus the natural logarithm of y, and so you'll end up with two terms, and you'll be able to take the derivative with respect to c, and that the derivative of the natural logarithm is 1 over c, and so that's where this term is going to come from, and then you'll have to take the derivative with respect to y, and that will give you a second term that we originally called non-ideality, okay? And so if you go back here to this expression, you can then plug this derivative into the flow equation, and you will get a flow equation that involves this connector term times the RT over C, and then this sum times DC DX, all right? And so that DC DX came from this term here, okay? And so this ends up being the flow equation. So remember I said we needed an expression to plug in to the flow equation so that we could write this down in terms of parameters that we might be able to solve for. All right. And so the plugging in then of this equation, we end up with a diffusion coefficient is equal to RT over NF, and then this 1 plus C2 term, and the DCDX term is what drops out or cancels out. So this ends up being a way of studying the flow and getting the diffusion coefficient. So what we've now done is we've expressed the diffusion coefficient in terms of a change in concentration and a frictional coefficient term. Okay, and so this ends up being the diffusion coefficient term, okay, RT over NF, okay, and that's what we end up plugging in. And then the non-ideality term can be gotten rid of if it's ideal, or it has to be included if it's not ideal. All right, and so what we're doing is we're equating terms here to the diffusion coefficient. So this is being written down. Let me go back and make sure I have here what I want to write down here. This is being written down in terms of this flow equation. And what they're recognizing is that this RT over NF, the LC term was derived in a previous slide. This is the definition of the diffusion coefficient. So there it is. And then this is the derivative with respect to X, but we also may have some kind of a non-ideality term that is reflected in the diffusion coefficient. So the diffusion coefficient need not be a constant. It can also vary with concentration. And that's the non-ideality. So this particular chapter then expresses what I just showed you up above in a similar way. There's an initial gradient, and then there's a spreading with time that gives you some kind of a Gaussian distribution if you take the derivative. And so here's the concentration as it spreads over infinite time or over long times, and there's a derivative. So the derivative actually has this Gaussian look to it, and it spreads in both directions, basically, in this sort of concentration distribution that you can characterize or study. Okay. And then this particular section talks about this as a Gaussian, and it solves for sort of the height of that derivative and the area under that derivative curve as a way of measuring the diffusion coefficient. So this was a method that was developed for analyzing this particular experimental setup. In its time in the 50s, this was known as a Gausting diffusiometer. It would set a sharp gradient and then monitor what was changing. I'm going to show you in a second how we did that. And then you took a derivative of the data, and you could actually take a derivative of the data optically. And then you would analyze the height and the area, and the variation in the area over the height gave you some information about the square root of the diffusion coefficient. So this is a way of measuring, okay? And so here's showing a plot as a function of time to get at diffusion coefficients. All right, so this is just a summary of values. And so we're beginning to now build up something. What I'm showing you is the kinds of materials that were studied in those days. Small molecules, small proteins, large proteins, viruses, etc. What their diffusion coefficients were and how it was done. Now, the G refers to this Gausting method. The S refers to sedimentation. I think the R refers to a refractometer method that I'm going to show you an image of where that was coming from. So this was the old methodology, and I'm going to bring you up to date eventually on all of this. The range of molecular weights, recall there's going to be a shape factor in this, and the diffusion coefficient. Now, the diffusion coefficient is generally converted to standard state. So we generally convert it to 20 degrees in water, because remember, the frictional coefficient has a viscosity term in it, and viscosity is temperature dependent, and then buffers contribute some viscosity. And so you have to sort of correct for all of that to get it in some kind of conditions where you can compare values. The units here, this is, means that the number is multiplied by 10 to the sixth, okay? And so these are really small units, but we bring them up to a larger value for our purposes. Generally speaking, six serum albumin has a diffusion coefficient of what is called 6 Fick. F is the term, okay? So I'm gonna write it up above here. It would be 6 Fick. And so that would have units of 10 to the minus 7th, actually, describing the amount of diffusion across some volume, excuse me, through some area per unit time. Eventually, we want to relate these diffusion coefficients. Remember, we've already sort of related these to a radius. we want to somehow have some way of thinking about molecular weights and radius and shape and relate all of these data together. Okay. So one of the optical systems that was developed was an absorption optical system. It basically had some kind of a source with lenses that focused the light onto the cell and then through a camera lens onto some kind of a photographic plate. And so if initially you had a sharp boundary, you could monitor the diffusion by looking at the optical density of the photograph on the plate. And you could actually monitor the change in concentration. So this initially was sharp and then it changes. And so this is one way of representing a flow or a change in concentration. You could imagine a cell with optics and some kind of a light source and some kind of a photographic system or visualization system as you are looking at this. You needed a camera lens to focus the result of the beam. Okay, and so what's happening in this kind of data, that's an absorption technique. What's happening in this kind of data is light is shining onto the cell and the light is bending. And the light bends because there's a refractive index in the solution. So the amount of bending is what we end up seeing the impact of. How much light bending do you see? And then that is all focused onto some kind of an optical system that allows you to visualize it, okay? And so it's this refractive index gradient that becomes the measure. And you can see that here, the greatest deflection occurs where the refractive index gradient is the largest. Okay, so if it's a constant concentration, the beam goes straight through. If there's nothing there, it goes straight through, and everywhere else you get some extent of bending. So you want to be able to turn that bending into information. Okay, so a second optical system that was developed took this concentration gradient and used some kind of a knife edge to cut off the image. And as you did that, cut off the image, you would see more and more of the image lost. Okay. And so this allowed you to get some kind of an information about position in the cell, because that's one of the things that you sort of needed. You didn't just need a photograph of everything, you needed some way of converting this to an actual radial position. Remember our continuity equation. The concentration is changing with time, but how is it changing at every position in the cell? And we needed some way of doing that. So this knife edge was one of the ways of people doing that. So not only did they do that, they then introduced some kind of a way of measuring the amount of deflection of the light. And so they put something called a Schlieren diaphragm into the path, and it measured the reflection of the deflection is the word I'm using, so that you could actually optically measure the gradient. And so the outcome of this were a couple of different lenses, the camera lens and then a cylindrical lens, that picked up the shape of the boundary. And so you would get a gradient moving down the cell. And as the boundary moved, this gradient, peak position and width would actually show up in the optical path. So you can actually watch the gradient by looking at the deflection of this peak or the motion of this peak, okay? And how big the peak was determined a little bit by that light edge design and the angle at which this diaphragm was rotated, okay? I'm not gonna go through all of this optical stuff. I actually took a course when I was a graduate student in what was called refractometric optics. How do you build and interpret data like this? Okay, so notice this is a single light source shining through a cell, and then it's giving you at the end some kind of an image. When I told you at the beginning, I would snap a picture, this is what I would see. And I would snap it at time 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and then develop. and you would try to time that during the time of sedimentation of your sample. Now, the Schlieren optical system was the primary technique that was used until the early 60s. And then in the 60s, people invented something called refractometric optics, which is a double beam technique. So light shined on a collimating lens, but then there was a sample and there was a reference. And so light would go through the reference and it would go through the entire optical system and it would go through the sample and the entire optical system. But the beam coming from the reference and the sample eventually were refocused on one another on the plate. And so you would end up seeing a concentration difference or a refractive index difference reflected in the shape of the pattern. So these are what we refer to as fringes. And you can convert these fringes to concentration depending on the wavelength of the light and the path of the entire optical system. This optical system was from light source to plate. The light source is actually in the bottom of a cell, usually shining up on a sample and then deflected along the length of the sample, the length of the machine. And this optical track was something like 6 feet to be able to be focused out here. It depended on the lenses that you use and what their optical path was, what their focal point was. And so you would basically now see the concentration gradient, all right? Excuse me, you would see the concentration distribution. You could take a derivative of this, or you could just plot this as concentration, okay? The problem here is that it's a deflection of the light that is measuring a difference in path, light through solution versus light through sample. And so what this position corresponded to was some offset. It didn't necessarily tell you exactly what the concentration was. That depended a little bit on what the flat part of the curve corresponded to. Okay. So I know it's a little bit after 7. So we're going to take a break at this point so that I can ask you if there are any questions at this point. Okay, so what we've done is we've introduced diffusion, we've introduced diffusion coefficients, we've introduced a relationship to frictional coefficients and potentially molecular dimensions, the radius, okay, or frictional coefficient ratios, F over F naught, and some information about shape that might give you a window into the structure of the macromolecule. Okay. So I'm then, from this point on, we'll get a little more detailed into how we actually do this today. I'll show you some examples. I'll show you examples over the next 2 weeks. But let's take a break right now, okay? So 5 minutes, and we'll pick up where I just left off. Okay?
by my.
Okay, are we back?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So this double beam technique is still available today in modern analytical ultracentrifuges. The absorbent system that I described at the very top is also available in a slightly different form in our modern instruments. My instrument has an absorbent system. It does not have a interference system. And then my instrument also has a fluorescent system, which I'll show you, I think in the next week. I'll show you data from that. I think that's where I've placed this. Okay. So today, if I want to make a diffusion coefficient measurement, I use dynamic light scattering. Okay. So in the chapter in Van Hold, they refer to dynamic light scattering. And it's in chapter 7. And so I've inserted some of the data from chapter 7 out of your book. So remember, this is the definition of D. Okay. And so in a dynamic light scattering apparatus, DLS, what you're really doing is you're looking at fluctuations in the scattering. You're looking at a fluctuation in the light intensity coming out of some kind of a cell. So you're shining usually a laser light onto it, and then the light is being scattered onto some kind of a photomultiplier. And what you're looking at is what's called the autocorrelation function. You're looking at the fluctuation in the light scattering. It's defined this way. This is the autocorrelation function. I'm not going to show you a lot of the details of this, but it's basically an intensity fluctuation that sort of falls off with position. And this is the instrument that I have in my lab. It's a Wyatt instrument. It's called a DynaPro Nanostar. You can't see it real clearly here. That's a cell. It's a plastic cell. I also have some quartz cells. You can see a little bit of a tower right here in the middle of the cell. That's where you fill it. but it actually connects to a small volume at the bottom that you can't see here. I would have to zoom in a lot. It only holds 4 microliters. And so you insert this into the cell. This is the door that's opened, and there's a slot here that you can't see in the shading. This fits into that. The door closes. It's temperature equilibrated with a Peltier cell. And then there's a laser that shines light down on that little thing that projects from the bottom of this cell, and you get scattering of light and you get a fluctuation in the light. Okay. That fluctuation reflects diffusion of the molecules in the cell. Okay. So it's a small element of volume. It's a laser, so it's a highly focused beam. And how many molecules are diffusing into and out of that volume? That's the intensity fluctuation. And then you analyze this intensity fluctuation in terms of an autocorrelation function, and that will output for you a diffusion coefficient. Okay. And so again, we're into diffusion coefficient, frictional coefficient, potential information about shape. All right. They discuss the fact that this has to be averaged over a fairly long time so that the fluctuations average out. All right. And so we usually collect data on a sample many times over the course, so many steps over the course of time, often repeated, often multiple loadings of the cells, et cetera, that gives you this information. The book talks about, this is a summary of some data from a paper that talks about a slightly different method. This technique is known as fluorescence recovery. So this is photo bleaching. Fluorescence recovery after photo bleaching, FRAP experiments, basically, where you initially irradiate a space and then you watch the molecules diffuse back into that space. And the rate at which this signal recovers gives you information about a diffusion coefficient. So everything that I've talked about up till now has had to do with solution. I introduced the idea of non-ideality and concentration dependence, but generally speaking, it was in some kind of a in vitro biological sort of buffer system. This paper introduces the fact that a lot of modern diffusion measurements are made in cells or in tissue. In this particular case, it's a fluorescently labeled piece of DNA or dextran in cells, and they're specifically looking at, in part A, the cytoplasm, and in part B, the nucleus. And then it's showing you the dextran over here on the right in the cytoplasm and in the nucleus. So what's varied here is the size of the DNA, 100 base pairs to 6,000 base pairs. And they're shining light to bleach the color in the fluorescein labeled DNA and then watching it recover over some period of time. And as you increase the size of the DNA, the recovery takes longer and longer, and then eventually it doesn't recover. And there are two things that you're looking for here. You're looking for the rate at which it recovers, and you're looking for the recovery of signal. And so you can see that there's some recovery of signal, though it's generally not 100%. And then as you get to bigger and bigger pieces of DNA, you see no recovery because big pieces of DNA don't diffuse very quickly or at all in the concentrated environment of a cytoplasm. In the nucleus, even the shortest pieces of DNA don't recover. And so there's some story here basically about the fact that the nucleus has DNA, in it, the chromatin, and it somehow interacts with these small pieces of DNA, and they don't diffuse because they're binding to something. Okay, what they're binding to and what the mechanism is a whole different thing. All right. The dextran doesn't behave this way. The dextran basically behaves the same way in the cytoplasm and in the nucleus. And so the dextran is insensitive to the presence of chromatin. It doesn't know what chromatin is. The DNA knows what chromatin is, and so that's what's different in the nucleus. And so this type of experiment gives you information in vitro about the apparent diffusion coefficient, right? The apparent diffusion coefficient. Remember the definition involved 6 pi eta r, the viscosity, and the radius. The radius here would be the equivalent radius of a rod, because DNA, of course, is a rod, all right? Up to some number of base pairs, it basically behaves like a rod, okay? But the D apparent also reflects the viscosity of the cytoplasm. And so this experiment becomes very complicated. Yes, I'm learning something about DNA, I'm learning something about interaction with chromatin, but how exactly do I interpret these data? And so this is a big problem in interpreting diffusion data in vivo, because there are a big bunch of unknowns having to do with how these viscosity influences, how the presence of hundreds of mgs per mil of protein influences the diffusion of a labeled material. Okay. All right, and so I think this summary is summarizing what I sort of just said, that what happens in the literature is people make a diffusion coefficient measurement. They interpret it in terms of a frictional coefficient. They assume that it's a sphere, and they report a Stokes radius, which tells you it usually is written down. It usually comes from this, and it's usually written down in this way, that I've made some assumptions that may not be true, and I need to make some corrections so that I'm sure that I'm talking about the equivalent sphere. And then I can infer something about the actual shape. And then more importantly, I need to worry about the concentration dependence. Now, I just showed you a figure that's out of the book on FRAP experiments in cells. This is a test tube experiment that I'm doing on serum albumin that happens to be labeled with a high molecular weight, 40,000 polyethylene glycol. And this is a repeat experiment. We did two preps to get different kinds of results. I'm measuring the diffusion coefficient as a function of concentration. I'm showing that the extrapolated value is essentially the same, 2.540, 2.538, but I'm getting slightly different values, which says that there's something different about these two samples that we made. I won't get into why that is. The equation that we use to interpret this essentially only involves some kind of a corrector that is concentration dependent. It's essentially the slope of this line. And you can see the slope of this line has a value somewhere between 17 and 30 milliliters per gram. The concentration is reflected in mgs per mil. So this has to have units of milliliters per gram to cancel out. So it's giving me some information about concentration dependence. Okay. Now, up above, we derived an expression. I won't go zipping back up there. In terms of a derivative of the frictional coefficient. Excuse me, a derivative of the activity coefficient, the non-ideality. So this term here is the non-ideality associated with diffusion. So I want to stop for a second. I'm increasing the concentration, the apparent diffusion, the number that's coming out of the Wyatt dynamic light scattering apparatus is increasing with concentration. So what's going on there? I'm telling you that it's non-ideality. What does that mean? Let me ask this a different way. If this data were doing this, if the diffusion coefficient were going down with concentration, what would that mean? So if you go back in this presentation, there was a table. No, I don't have to do this. Can I escape from here? No, I can't. I want to keep the annotation. If I go back in, I didn't need to do that. I could have just gone back. There was a table here. Let me go back here. Molecular weight versus diffusion coefficient. As I go down from 13,000 to 90,000 to 400,000 to 47 million, the diffusion coefficient is going down. Big things diffuse more slowly than small things. Okay? That's sort of an obvious rule. Big things will diffuse more slowly than small things. So the relationship between the diffusion coefficient and a molecular weight is inverse. The diffusion coefficient is proportional to 1 over the molecular weight to some power, okay? I don't know what the relationship is yet, but it's inverted, okay? So in this figure of data that I'm showing you, if the diffusion was going down, that would mean in a concentration-dependent way, I was making a bigger molecule. I was assembling into some kind of an oligomer, some kind of a complex. Instead, what happens is this monomer becomes diffuses faster as I raise the concentration. I'm pausing because I want you to think about that. Why would it diffuse faster with concentration? It's a reflection of this non-ideality term. It's a reflection of this KD, the concentration dependence of D. So partially one way of thinking about this, it's the derivative of an activity coefficient. So thermodynamically, you don't need anything more than non-ideality and the concentration dependence of the activity coefficient. Mechanistically, as you raise the concentration, the molecules sense other molecules, and the volume that they diffuse into becomes reduced because two molecules can't occupy the same space at the same time. So they diffuse faster in the smaller available space. It looks like they're diffusing faster because the volume is decreasing with concentration. Often data in this field is not plotted as concentration, it's plotted as volume fraction. What volume is available to the molecule? In a cell, the volume fraction is dramatically reduced. Often the macromolecules in a typical cell, I think that was Hela in that experiment, might be 30-40% volume fraction of macromolecule. And macromolecule in this case includes microtubules and ribosomes and all the other big stuff, membranes, et cetera, that are getting in the way, okay? And so the diffusion coefficient in cells reflects how much space is available to them. They are literally blocked from diffusing, but they have smaller volume to diffuse into. In vitro, this is an in vitro experiment. We're raising the concentration. This is not a very high concentration from the perspective of a cellular environment, but even at these concentrations, the molecule diffuses faster. The apparent diffusion coefficient is faster because two molecules can't occupy the same space at the same time, and so they're diffusing into a smaller available volume. Okay, and so the fluctuations seem to increase. And so we interpret this as an extrapolated value. The D0 is the extrapolated value, where concentration goes to zero. And the slope of this line, which gives you something about the concentration dependence. Okay. The concentration dependence of these parameters tells you something about, in a broad sense, activity coefficients, but we'll want to say a lot more about that concentration dependence as well. How do you measure that? You already know what I'm talking about because I had you measure, or I had you calculate in one of the homework assignments, the virial coefficient for DNA in terms of excluded volume. So right here, we're mostly talking about excluded volume and charge, the Donnan effect. This slope reflects whatever that equivalent non-ideality is due to the shape of the molecule, the volume of the molecule, and if there is any charge-charge attraction or charge-charge repulsion. Attraction would give you this red line. Repulsion gives you these lines up above. Okay. So now we're going to change direction and we're going to talk about sedimentation in the last 20 minutes or so. All right. So an analytical ultracentrifuge has a rotor that rotates and it has holes that you can put cells in. So the cells are shown here on the left. It's some kind of a housing that has a window. Here's a window at the top and at the bottom and at the top. That's sandwiched in between is a cell. The cell has these sector-shaped chambers so that the force lines run parallel to the side of the channels. Remember I said that the area does not have to be constant, flow in, flow out. Okay, this whole thing is torqued down. It's filled through these filling holes, which are then sealed. And so you have a sample. Generally, you have a sample and you have a reference. So this is usually done in some kind of a double beam mode. Okay, in this system, absorbance, the lamp flashes on the reference, it flashes on the sample, it flashes on the reference, it flashes on the sample as it moves along the cell. It's not the lamp that's moving, it's some kind of a slit assembly that collects light at different radial positions. Okay. So there's rotation and sedimentation. Initially, this is a constant concentration, and then a boundary is made up and it sediments under the force of the rotation. And so over time, you'll get this moving boundary. And so you'll have a reference that is buffer And then you'll have a moving boundary that reflects the buffer left behind and the sample pelleting. You'll have this plateau that is sedimenting towards the bottom, and then it will build up at the bottom here. Notice once you establish a concentration gradient, there'll be diffusion. So this boundary will diffuse. So the continuity equation for sedimentation in a sector-shaped cell involves a change in concentration with time is equal to 1 over r drj dr. The 1 over r term reflects the sector shape nature of the cell. The flow equation is in terms of a sedimentation coefficient and a diffusion coefficient. The sedimentation coefficient reflects the speed of rotation. The diffusion coefficient reflects the concentration gradient, this gradient in the boundary that causes it to diffuse. I will derive all of this in a second, okay? And so this is the situation that you're attempting to analyze by looking at the change in concentration with time as a function of position. We're basically looking at the shape of this boundary and how it sediments and how it diffuses. That's what the two terms are. Okay, so here's a depiction similar to what I showed you up above. We have an angular velocity. This cell is spinning at some speed. I typically spin anywhere between 20 and 50,000 revolutions per minute. A particle in this solution has a force. The force on it comes from the angular velocity. It has a drag that reflects the velocity times a frictional coefficient term. And it has a buoyancy term. And that buoyancy term reflects the fact that as this molecule sediments, it displaces solvent. And the solvent has to move in the other direction. So this was shown up above as a backflow. The backflow is what gives you the buoyancy term. Okay, so in terms of design, there's a meniscus, depending on how much you fill the cell. There's a cell bottom where it builds up. It's sector shape that reflects the equation for the continuity. So here are the three terms expressed again. There's a sedimentation term, there's a buoyancy term, there's a drag term. The buoyancy term reflects the fact that there's a backflow of solvent. The solvent is reflected here in an M0 term, the mass of the solution displaced. So that would be the buffer, basically. Okay. The force, the centrifuge force, is omega squared R. Omega, sorry, is not defined here, is it? So omega is 2 pi RPM over 60. That's the angular velocity, and it's squared in this equation. Okay, so this is breaking it up into revolutions per second, basically. That's what the dividing by 60 is about. Omega squared R times the mass of the molecule that's sedimenting. As you go to higher R, the force increases. Then there's a buoyancy term that reflects the backflow of the solvent that's being displaced. And it literally sets up a flow that counteracts this sedimentation. And then there's a drag that reflects, just like in the previous derivation, a frictional coefficient times a velocity. Okay? So we can imagine what the mass of the solvent is in terms of macromolecular characteristics. This mass is equivalent to the mass of the macromolecule times the volume of the macromolecule, the partial specific volume, times the density of the solution. So this gives the equivalent volume or the equivalent mass of solvent due to the macromolecule. This is how much is being displaced, okay? So the volume of the macromolecule times its mass corrected for the density of solution. So when you exchange this into the equation up above, you then have an omega squared r m, where the m common term comes out, and you have two terms, one that reflects the mass of the macromolecule and the other reflects the displacement of the solvent. This becomes what's called a one minus V bar rho term. This is what's called the buoyancy term, okay? Now think about this for a second. If the density of the solution were close to the partial specific volume, this wouldn't sediment, it would be buoyant. If the density of the solution is lighter than the macromolecule, this molecule will sediment. If the density of the solution is heavier, then this molecule will actually float. Okay, so the buoyancy term determines how different the macromolecule is relative to the solution. Does it sink? Does it float? Does it stay buoyant? Does it band, in other words? And I'll show you examples of that at the very end. That'll be next week. When we were talking about the second virial coefficient calculation, I told you that the V bar of a protein is typically around 0.73. And I told you that the V bar of RNA or DNA is about 0.55. And there was an example of a virus that might be a mixture of both of those. And so this was going to be an average. So this buoyancy term here reflects, is it a protein or is it DNA? With this buoyancy term, this DNA per unit mass will sediment faster than protein. If it was some kind of a lipid, okay, let's put an L here, where this is actually one or greater than one, this guy will float. It will go in the other direction. I don't know how many of you use a preparative centrifuge. When you burst open cells and you sediment them to get rid of the cell debris and to recover the protein that you're expressing in cells, you're often using a fixed angle rotor. So it's some kind of a fixed angle. The pellet for the cells ends up here. Your debris ends up in here. So this is where you find your expressed protein. And often right here is another pellet. It's actually on the inside edge because it's moving inward. It's floating to the surface of the solution. And that's usually membrane. That's usually lipid. Okay. And so the buoyancy dictates which direction things go. All right. So we've rearranged this equation. We've written the displacement, the buoyancy term in terms of this MV bar rho term. And then we've rearranged this so that it's the omega squared RM times a buoyancy term, and then the frictional drag is set equal to zero. If I rearrange this so that the velocity is on one side, and if I divide by omega squared R is what we call the field. So this is velocity per unit field. We did the same thing in electrophoresis. We did velocity per unit field and we called this the mobility. And then we wrote out an equation. Okay, so the velocity per unit field has a definition. It's the sedimentation coefficient. And what's left on the other side is the mass. If we multiply and divide by Avogadro's number, this is Avogadro times the mass of a single particle. because this representation here is a single particle. Then we have the mass, the molecular weight of whatever this particle is. So in Avogadro's number of particles, times a buoyancy term divided by a frictional coefficient is equal to the sedimentation coefficient. In the equation up above for diffusion coefficient, remember it was RT over NF. Shape was the only factor. Mass seems to be invisible there. Okay, this is not entirely true because we've already spoken about the fact that big molecules diffuse more slowly than small molecules. Okay, so there's some connection to mass in here, but it's sort of hidden in what the frictional term is. In this equation, a particle will sediment proportional to its mass, but inversely proportional to its shape. Okay, so irregular particles, spheres will sediment the fastest because they have the most compact shape. Extended molecules, random coils or rods, et cetera, will sediment more slowly. And so you need to get information about the mass and about the shape to be able to interpret a sedimentation coefficient, okay? All of this depends upon the buoyancy term, but the buoyancy term is basically a known. You gotta know what V bar is, you gotta know what the density of the solution is to be able to interpret the data. Okay, so this is a depiction of what a moving boundary looks like. Up above, we had a picture of this as this is the meniscus. A particle begins to sediment. It breaks away from the meniscus. As you set up a gradient, it begins to diffuse, and you can see the broadening of the boundary. So this is the concentration in some units, absorbance or reflection of interference fringes or something versus position. So I'm interested in knowing how fast this boundary is moving and how much this boundary is spreading. And that will give me information about both S and D. The way this is done in the absorbance system is there's a lamp at the bottom of the cell. It's called a xenon flash lamp. It goes through a photomultiplier. It goes through an instrument that selects for light. Okay, so it gives a monochromator that can select for light wavelengths. So 280 for proteins, 260 for DNA, et cetera. It shines down on the cells that are spinning. There's a way of optically focusing that light down on a slit assembly and down on a photomultiplier. This slit assembly moves during the run, so it collects signals at different radial positions. And it usually collects signals on one cell, followed by the next, followed by the next. Okay, it takes some time to do the measurement. Okay, the velocity is the rate in change with time. So if you know what the boundary position is, you can imagine this is a peak and a derivative, or the midpoint in those concentration plots, then this is reflected in this omega squared R term. If I come up above here, this is what we're dealing with. Velocity, but velocity is dr dt is equal to omega squared R times S. So that's rearranging that equation. And then it's essentially integrating this equation, bringing R to the left. And so when you do that, it becomes dr over R. That's actually dlnr. So it becomes a logarithm of the position. And you bring T to the right, and this becomes omega squared S times T. So it's the integral of dt. So it's T at T zero to T. And so what this says is that if you plot the logarithm, the natural logarithm of the position of the boundary versus time, the slope of that line will give you the sedimentation coefficient. Okay, so this is the way when I would snap five pictures, I would convert the data the peak and the derivative of the Schlieren pattern, I would convert the data to an S value, 5 points. That's not what we do today. We actually monitor to the entire shape of the boundary. Okay. Now, I'll come to that later in the presentation because this has to sort of build. This is a depiction of what we've already said, but it's showing it to you not in terms of just a diffusion experiment, but in terms of a sedimentation experiment. There are two images, I think, coming up. One involves the subunits that weigh around 350,000 of a hemocyanin, and one that involves a oligomer of hemocyanin subunits that are approximately 10 times larger. So this is showing an old Schlieren pattern of this experiment, okay? It's showing time to the left, it's moving to the left. It's showing two boundaries separating. And as the two boundaries separating, you see peaks. It's showing you a fast boundary that sediments very quickly. You can tell that by the time. And then it's showing you a slow boundary. And the slow boundary sediments more slowly. And so you can see after 38 minutes, this boundary is gone and this boundary is still there, okay? The sharpness of the peak is how high this is. So that's a steep boundary. It's a very sharp boundary. The broadness of this peak showing you diffusion, how much diffusion is occurring in the subunits. So this is the complex and these are the subunits, and it's showing you the difference in the diffusion of the boundary, the sedimentation of the boundary. It sediments faster because it's big. In the diffusion, it diffuses more because it's lower molecular weight. So in the modern setup where we plot concentration, this is showing you the same data, okay? This is the oligomer. It's sedimenting faster. So now it's being shown left to right, not right to left. Meniscus base on the far right. It's showing that the oligomer is sedimenting faster. Notice that the gradient is sharp. The subunits are sedimenting slower. They've only moved a little bit from the meniscus, but they're already beginning to diffuse and spread. And this gradient is already shallower than this gradient, okay? And so big things sediment fast and diffuse very little. Small things sediment slow and diffuse more rapidly. Those are general sort of concepts. I won't go through all of this. Because the cell is sector shaped, as it moves through the sector, it moves into a bigger volume and so it gets diluted. And so there's a radial dilution phenomena that goes on that I'll show you an image of later. And so here's a depiction of the fact that the volume gets bigger because of the angle on the sector shape. And between this volume element and this volume element, there's actually a dilution going on. Okay, so there's a small dilution that occurs during the experiment that we have to count for. And then this is showing the fact that we simply correct for 20 degrees in water by correcting for things like the V-bar and the density and the viscosity of the different materials. I'm not going to go through all of that. And showing that the density is temperature dependent and the viscosity is temperature dependent to a large extent. Okay. I have a density meter, so I actually can measure the density of solutions. It's actually a tuning fork. What you can't really see here, this is actually a U-shaped tuning fork that vibrates, and the frequency at which it vibrates tells me how much mass is in there, and knowing the volume, I can tell you what the density is. So here's a temperature, and here's information about the density. This is actually an empty cell. It's probably air. And then this is a viscometer. This thing over here is a tube, and this whole device tilts, and a ball in it, a falling ball moves, and it measures the time that it takes for the ball to fall. And it tilts down and up, down and up, down and up, measuring the time that it takes to fall through a viscous media, and you can convert that to a viscosity. So both of these devices have Peltier cells. We can do this as a function of temperature, et cetera. So all of this density viscosity stuff that I'm mentioning here is something that we measure and we keep track of. Okay, I'm going to stop now. What we're about to get into is concentration dependence of a sedimentation coefficient and where it comes from and how we incorporate that into the analysis of the data. Okay, so let's stop sharing because it's almost 12 o'clock and I'm going over time as usual. Any questions? Okay. So what I'm trying to do is build some appreciation for what you use diffusion data and sedimentation data for. How diffusion data relates to frictional coefficients and shape and dimensions. How I will now show you how sedimentation data relates to frictional coefficients and shapes. And how all of them together can be used to determine molecular weights and how you interpret that data. Okay, so that last part is going to take another, I don't know, the way I've set it up, it's going to take another 20 slides. So we'll be at a point where we can collect and interpret sedimentation data in terms of frictional coefficients and shapes, diffusion data in terms of frictional coefficients and shapes. That's not where I really want to be. That's very fundamental information. Here's a protein that I've isolated. How big is it? What's its shape? That was sort of at the very beginning in the slide. What's its mass? Is it a monomer or is it an oligomer? So we want to get to that because I've already showed you oligomers sediment faster and diffuse less quickly. Monomer sediment slower and diffuse more quickly. But that's not all I want. I want to know the equilibrium between the monomers and the polymers. Can I study that too? Can I actually get an equilibrium constant for that too? Can I learn something about the mechanism of assembly? In that example, the hemocyanin was a tenmer. It went from 350,000 to 3.5 million or something. Did I determine that it was a tenmer? Does it go 10 monomers to 10? Or does it have intermediate structures? Does it make intermediates? Can I determine what that mechanism is? You had a problem set that involved monomer, dimer, tetramer, different pathways to get to it, different concentration dependence, different temperature dependence, et cetera. Can I get that information? Okay. That is where we actually want to go. What the centrifuge is valuable for initially was, oh, look, protein sediment with a single S value. And it's in a homogeneous boundary based upon the shape. Oh my goodness, a protein is actually a thing. It has a shape, it has a structure, it has a sequence. Okay, in the 20s, we didn't know that. It's called what? Okay, the sequence of the protein, the primary, and then it has a shape because it sediments at different rates. Oh, I can learn something about the secondary, tertiary structure. Oh, wait a minute, this protein seems to be made up of four subunits. I can now learn about quaternary structure. Okay, so that's what the centrifuge was used for in the 20s and the 30s and the 40s. Starting in the 50s and especially in the 60s, we started solving problems. Oh, look, I can get the equilibrium constant. This is a monomer dimer. I can actually vary the concentration and study monomer dimer equilibrium. I can do temperature dependence and get the enthalpy. Okay, I can do salt dependence and learn something about the salt dependence of the reaction, how many ions of salt are involved in the reaction, et cetera. So that's really where we're going, okay? It's gonna take us two more weeks to completely get there, but that's where we're going, okay? So you can look ahead, you can see I do a bunch of stuff on sedimentation. We start talking about other factors like hydration. And then I'll show you some other methodology that's been used. And then eventually I'll show you some papers that solve these problems that I'm describing to you. I'm going to show you papers from Timashev in the 70s, okay, the beginning of my scientific career, not yours, obviously. And then I'm going to show you a paper that my lab published that complements basically what the Timashev lab did in those days. Okay. Are there any questions at all? All right. Next week, probably the end of the lecture, there'll be another assignment. That assignment may actually be tied to the papers that we publish, that we go over the following week. I think we won't be able to start those papers by the end of the lecture next week because I want to do some other papers. A lot of it's historical. You by this time know that I like to do the historical side of this stuff. And so I'll show you a number of different things. And then in 2 weeks, we'll get into both Timashev papers and my paper. Okay. So are we going over problems on Friday? Is that something you would like to do?
Yes.
Yes.
All right. So Friday, hold on a second. This Friday is okay. So we're going to do it again at 11. Is that okay?
Yeah, that works with me.
Everybody else?
Okay.
All right.
Yes, that's fine.
In 2 weeks, I have a faculty meeting. So we'll have to change the day in 2 weeks. Change the time and it's a second Friday. All right. I'll see you Friday.
Thank you, Dr. Correa. Have a good day.
Thank you.
Thanks, Dr. Correa.